Welcome to PEAKS, my dear students. We are going to discuss the topic digestion, nutrition and absorption. In this chapter, today we are going to discuss part 1, nutrition. Let us see what is nutrition. Nutrition is the process by which organisms obtain the various substances necessary for maintenance and other metabolic activities of the body. And these substances supply energy required for synthesizing organic molecules, and they form biological structures and carry the essential life processes. And this energy can be obtained directly from sunlight or from food. Now, what are the different types of nutrition? Based on the method of food acquirement, nutrition is classified into 2. First, autotrophic nutrition, and such animals are called autotrophs. And they are able to synthesize their own food. And the second type of nutrition is called heterotrophic nutrition, and such animals are called heterotrophs, and they are not able to synthesize their own food, and they have to depend upon other animals for their food. And based on the source of energy they get for the synthesis of food, autotrophs are again classified into 2, and A, photoautotrophs, and B, chemoautotrophs. And photoautotrophs utilize light energy for the synthesis of food, example green plants and green protist, and this is the figure of a green protist. And green protist are eukaryotic, and they are microscopic organisms, and they contain these green substances called chloroplast, and chloroplast contain chlorophyll, and the process of food production is called photosynthesis. And they contain photoautotrophs contain chlorophyll or similar pigments, and they are able to absorb the light energy. And they use carbon dioxide and water, and they synthesize food in presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. Next one are hemoautotrophs, and they synthesize organic materials using chemical energy, and the process is called chemosynthesis. Example, sulfur, iron and nitrifying bacteria. And this is the diagram of a sulfur bacteria, and this is an iron bacteria, and they both derive energy by the oxidation of sulfur and iron respectively. Then coming to heterotrophic nutrition, heterotrophs are unable to synthesize their own food, and they depend upon other organisms. Example, all animals, fungi, some bacteria and many protists. And again, based on the methods of food collection, heterotrophic nutrition is divided into 4 types. First one is holozoic nutrition. It is the process of taking in or engulfing whole or part of an animal, either in solid state or liquid state, and digested with the help of enzymes within definite digestive tract or similar organ. Such organisms are called holotrophs. All vertebrates and most invertebrates are holotrophs, and an example is given here as amoeba. You can see an amoeba approaching a food particle, and you can see pseudopods are put forth around the food particle. And now in the third stage, pseudopods are put forth around the food particle. The food particle is formed as a food vacuole, and it is engulfed by the amoeba and digested. The second type of nutrition is called saprozoic nutrition. It is a process of absorption of decaying organic material through the general body surface, and the organisms are called saprophytes. Some bacteria, some fungi, and a few protozoans are the examples. You can see the diagrams of a few saprophytic fungi, which are saprophytes. Then the third type is parasitic nutrition. That is a process of derivation of food from other living organisms called host, without necessarily killing them or causing some disease. Examples are pathogenic bacteria, then plasmodium, which is a malarial parasite, then tapeworm, viruses, and a few fungi called Puccinia. This is the diagram of a fungi called Puccinia infecting the leaves of certain plants. This is the diagram of a tapeworm, which is infecting both man and pig. And the last type is symbiotic nutrition, where two organisms live in association and derive food from each other. One example is Escherichia coli, that is the bacteria living in the gut of man producing the vitamin B12, that is cyanocobalamin. This is the diagram of Escherichia coli. Here this bacteria derive nutrients from the gut of man, and in turn man gets vitamin B12 that is prepared by the bacteria. And second example is Trichonympha, that is a flagellate protozoan living in the intestine of wood eating termite, and the termite gets the wood digested by the flagellate, and the flagellate in turn gets nutrients from the gut of the termite. And coming to mixotrophic nutrition, here when an organism resorts to more than one type of nutrition, it is called mixotrophic nutrition. And Euglena viridis is an example, and in the figure you can see the green chloroplast inside the animal, and it is autotrophic in presence of sunlight. That is, during day time Euglena synthesizes its own food, but during darkness the animal cannot synthesize its food, and it absorbs food through the body surface. That is, it is saprophytic in darkness. So since it shows two types of nutrition, it is called a mixotrophic animal. We can go to different types of holozoic nutrition. First type is herbivores, that is vegetarians, animals feeding on plants. Example, rabbit, cow and elephant. Second type, flesh eating animals, that is carnivores, lion, tiger and dog. Then third type, that is mixed type, animals eating on both plants and flesh, omnivores. Example, man, crow and cockroach. Then besides this, there is another type of classification, that is animals eating on insects called insectivores. Example, lizards, toads and spiny anteaters. Then frugivores, animals eating on fruits. Example, monkeys, birds and bats. Then animals which feed on blood, they are called sanguinivores. Leeches, vampire bats and female mosquitoes. Then animals feeding on detritus, they are called detritivores. Example, earthworm. Animals feeding on fluid food are called fluid feeders, male mosquitoes and butterflies. we can go to different steps in holozoic nutrition. And the first step is ingestion. Ingestion is the taking enough food. Then according to the size of the food particles that are taken in, ingestion is divided into two. First one is microphagy. Micro means small. When small particles of food are taken in, it is called microphagy. Example, amoeba and paramecium. In amoeba, we have seen amoeba taking in small particles of food, and it is the diagram of paramecium inside which we can see small particles of food. And next type is macrophagy. Macro means large particles, where you can see large particles are ingested in. And non-chordates and most chordates are examples, including man. Second step is digestion. Digestion is the process in which food particles taken in are digested by means of enzymes into simpler substances. And the third step is absorption, that is the digested materials are absorbed into the bloodstream and lymph. And the fourth step is ejection, that is undigested and unabsorbed materials are thrown out as feces. And digestion, absorption and ejection, we are going to deal in detail in the next class. What are the different types of nutrients? Carbohydrates, proteins and fats are considered as organic nutrients because they contain carbon. And vitamins, minerals and water are grouped as inorganic nutrients. And first we are going to deal carbohydrates. They contain carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. Example, the common examples are honey, bread, potato, wheat, rice. And the main nutritional role is the production of energy. And the most important form of carbohydrate in human food is the starch, the digestion of which produces glucose. And some other examples are glucose, sucrose, etc. Then these are the three common steps in the metabolism of carbohydrate. First step is glycogenesis. That is, after digestion and absorption, if there is excess glucose in blood, this glucose is stored in liver and muscle in the form of glycogen. And this process is called glycogenesis. Then the next process is glycogenolysis. If and when the blood glucose level lowers below normal in the blood, then the stored glycogen in the liver is broken down to glucose, and it mainly occurs in liver, and that process is known as glycogenolysis. And the third process is gluconeogenesis, that is, under acute starvation, the liver cells convert non-carbohydrate materials such as amino acids, glycerol, etc. into glucose. So, remember these terms: glycogenesis, glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis. Coming to proteins, they are nitrogenous substances, they are nitrogen containing substances formed by the association of several simple units called amino acids, and they contain carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur and other elements. And the natural sources are meat, egg, milk, fish and pulses. Then let us see what are the functions of proteins. They function chiefly as body builders. They help in the transport of materials in and out of the plasma membrane, and they are known as transmembrane proteins. And the third function is they are carriers of immunoglobulins, and they function as metabolic regulators. Example, hormones, and one example of hormone is insulin. Then they function as biological catalyst. Then there are 20 amino acids, of which 8 are called essential amino acids because they cannot be synthesized in the body, and they must be supplied with food in adequate amount. And the rest of the 12 amino acids are called non-essential amino acids because they can be synthesized by the cells. Of the 12 non-essential amino acids, arginine and histidine are again called semi-indispensable amino acids because even though they can be synthesized by cells, they can be formed in the body only very slowly. The animal proteins are considered as first class proteins because they contain adequate amount of all essential amino acids. And plant proteins are considered to be nutritionally inferior to animal proteins in one or two essential amino acids. The protein requirement in diet is more during pregnancy, lactation, infancy, and childhood. And coming to fats or lipids. Lipids contain carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen in different proportions, and they contain fatty acids on, they are compounds of fatty acids and glycerol. And fat oxidation produces 2¼ times more energy yielded by the same weight of carbohydrates or proteins. Lipids form the structural components of cells, like phospholipids of cell membrane. And after digestion, lipids form fatty acids and glycerol. Then linoleic acid and linolenic acid and arachidonic acid are the essential fatty acids, that is, they cannot be synthesized in the body, and they form the constituent of the membrane lipids. And for a balanced diet in man, the diet should contain 10% to 20% of the total calorie requirement of fat. But athletes and other manual laborers take more than 40% of their food calories in the form of fat. Then coming to the calorific value of carbohydrates, protein, and fat. Then, what is calorific value? The amount of energy released by the degradation of 1 gram of food within the body of an organism is called physiological fuel value. That is, the degradation of 1 gram of food within the body is called physiological fuel value. And gross calorific value is the calorie released in the lab. So, physiological fuel value is always lower than the gross calorific value. And daily requirement of a person depends upon the kind of work done, state of health, bulkiness of the body, age, sex, etc. A moderately active male requires 2800 kilocalories daily, while a similar woman requires only 2200 kilocalories. Then what is basal metabolic rate? The energy required by an organism at rest is called basal metabolic rate. You remember, the energy required by an organism at rest, it is called basal metabolic rate. Then coming to another type of nutrient, vitamins. Vitamins are certain organic molecules required in trace amounts for the normal functioning of the body. Most of them are synthesized by plants and essential to animals, and animals can synthesize only a few. They act in association with enzymes, influencing a number of vital reactions. Based on the solubility, vitamins are classified into two: fat soluble vitamins and water soluble vitamins. Fat soluble vitamins are A, D, and E and K. So, for convenience to remember, they are called ADAC. First, we will consider vitamin A. Vitamin A are present in all orange and red vegetables and fruits, and all green leafy vegetables, egg yolk and fish liver oil. And vitamin A is present in plants as an yellow or red pigment called carotene, which in the animal body is converted into vitamin A. And such precursors of vitamin are said to be provitamin. So, carotene is the provitamin, and it is essential for the formation of the retinal pigment rhodopsin of rod cells of the eye and iodopsin of the cone cells, and they are essential for vision in dim light and bright light. And deficiency of this vitamin produces xerophthalmia in children and night blindness in adults. You can see that the figure of a xerophthalmia, you can see the dryness of the cornea, and you have read and you all know that in India it is the major cause of blindness in children. You can see the dry cornea. Then this vitamin is also essential for the normal health and growth of the epithelial tissue, and deficiency causes drying out of the epithelial tissue, and it will cause bacterial infection. Hence, it is also called an anti-infection vitamin. And hypervitaminosis means overdose. Overdose is also dangerous because it is a fat soluble vitamin. So, it will not be thrown out through the urine. It will be stored in the body, and it will lead to drowsiness, sluggishness, headache and vomiting. Next one is vitamin D. It is a steroid occurring in different forms. It occurs in shark liver oil, egg, milk, etc. It is synthesized in human skin from a cholesterol derivative by the action of the UV rays of sunlight. Hence, it is known as sunshine vitamin. You all know that it is better to have sunlight before 8 o'clock in the morning and after 4 o'clock, so that body will be synthesizing this material in the this vitamin in the body with the help of sunlight. And vitamin D increases intestinal absorption of calcium and phosphorus, and also regulate the deposition of calcium in the bones. Then it is also essential for the normal development of teeth. and deficiency causes a disease called rickets in children and osteomalacia in adults. And osteomalacia means softening of bones, and this is rickets. And symptoms are bowing of ribs. Ribs villu pole valanjirikkum, then beaded ribs, ribs muttu pole thonnikkum, defective joints, teeth, etc. In adults, softening, this is a normal bone, this is an osteomalacia bone, calcium deposition onnum illa, then calcium and loss of calcium and phosphorus deposits, fracture of bones you can see. So, this is a rickets baby and this is a man with osteomalacia. Then vitamin E present in germinating seeds, nuts, egg yolk, butter and vegetable oils. It helps to maintain normal fertility of both male and female, hence called anti-sterility vitamin. It is also concerned with cell metabolism and cell differentiation. And deficiency in male may cause immobile sperms and male infertility, and also it may cause miscarriage and stillbirth. Then vitamin K, it is present in spinach, cheera, cabbage, cauliflower, soya bean, coriander tops and radish tops. It catalyzes the synthesis of prothrombin. Prothrombin is a plasma protein which helps in blood clotting and certain plasma factors for blood clotting. Thus, it helps in blood coagulation and prevents bleeding. So, it is also called an anti-hemorrhagic vitamin. Then, vitamin K is manufactured by human colon bacteria. So, prolonged use of antibiotics may destroy this bacteria, which in turn will result in the deficiency of vitamin K. That is why doctors nowadays prescribe, along with antibiotics, they prescribe bacteria also, so that colon bacteria will not be destroyed so much. Deficiency will prolong clotting time. Now, coming to water soluble vitamins, that is B complex and C. B complex vitamins include 10 different vitamins and grouped as B complex. They differ in their chemical structure and effects, and they are referred to by their chemical name. Most of them act as coenzymes in catalyzing various biochemical reactions. What are coenzymes? Coenzymes are non-protein part of the enzymes, and they are mostly vitamins, and along with the protein part, they together take part in the catalyzing reactions. Then major B complex vitamins, vitamin B1 present in cereals, mainly in rice bran. Rice bran nu parna tavid. Then pulses, pyru vargangal, nuts, liver, meat. It forms an enzyme, thiamine pyrophosphate, which is essential for carbohydrate metabolism and also for amino acid metabolism. It deficiency causes a disease called beriberi. This is the figure of a person suffering from beriberi. Symptoms are damages to nerve, atrophy of muscles, swelling and paralysis of arms and legs, etc. And this disease is prevalent in areas where polished rice is the staple food. That is, tavidu kalanja ari koodathal kaikkunna pradeshangalilana beriberi ettavum koodathal ullathu. Ariyude tavidilana ee vitamin ettavum koodathal ullathu. Then vitamin B2, that is present in milk, curd, pulses and green leafy vegetables. It is essential to keep healthy skin and oral mucosa. Then it forms two coenzymes such as flavin mononucleotide and flavin adenine dinucleotide. Deficiency causes chylosis, that is fissures at the corner of the mouth, and glossitis, that is inflammation of the tongue. Then vitamin B5 present in liver, pulses, cereals, etc. It can be also synthesized from the amino acid tryptophan. It forms two coenzymes, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide and nicotinamide adenine diphosphate. For many dehydrogenase enzymes of cellular respiration. And deficiency causes a disease called pellagra. The symptoms are, you can see from the figure, a scaly pigmented skin, then dementia nu parna ormakkuravu, then diarrhea, then redness of the skin, then abdominal pain and mental disorder. And it also causes a disease called canine disease or black tongue. Then the next vitamin B complex is vitamin B6, present in liver, egg, pulses, milk, etc. It also serves as an important coenzyme in amino acid metabolism. Deficiency causes gastrointestinal disturbances and impaired protein metabolism and causes impaired antibody production. Now, coming to an important vitamin, vitamin B9, that is folic acid. You must have heard a lot about folic acid deficiency, present in egg, liver, milk, green leafy vegetables, etc. It is synthesized by human colon bacteria. It forms a coenzyme which help in DNA synthesis. Folic acid is essential for growth, cell division and formation and maturation of RBC. And deficiency leads to macrocytic or megaloblastic anemia, characterized by, you can see in the diagram, large immature nucleated RBC with a reduction in the number of RBC and a reduction in the quantity of hemoglobin. What will happen? There is a reduction in the quantity of hemoglobin. There will be a reduction in the transport of oxygen content. So, the person will feel fatigue and breathlessness. And deficiency in pregnant women lead to low birth weight and neural tube defect children. That is why during the early stages of pregnancy, doctors will prescribe folic acid. And deficiency will cause gastrointestinal disorders also. Then vitamin B12, and the speciality of this vitamin is it is absent in plants and vegetarians. So, vegetarians have to drink a lot of milk. It is present in milk, egg yolk, fish, meat, oysters, etc. But it is synthesized by some human colon bacteria, and its absorption from the intestine requires Gasyl's intrinsic factor secreted by the gastric mucosa. And from the name itself, it is known that it is a cobalt containing vitamin essential for the synthesis of nucleic acid, and it is essential for the normal nerve function and maturation and growth of RBC. So, deficiency will cause a type of anemia called pernicious anemia with nucleated enlarged immature RBC. In the normal human being, RBC is not nucleated, and deficiency may also cause nerve damage. Then the next one is pantothenic acid. Sources are milk, liver, egg and sweet potato. It is an integral part of the coenzyme A. Coenzyme A is an important coenzyme because it is involved in the metabolism of carbohydrates, proteins and fats in the transfer of energy. And it is also, this vitamin is necessary for the normal functioning of nerves and skin. So, deficiency causes dermatitis, that is inflammation of the skin, degenerative changes in the nervous system, anemia and retarded growth. The next one is biotin. Liver, yeast, egg yolk and milk are the important sources. It is also a component of different coenzymes. Deficiency result in the inflammation of the skin, increased secretion of the sebum and loss of appetite. Sebum, you know, it is a secretion of the sebaceous gland present in the skin. Then coming to vitamin C. We all know vitamin C is present in all the fruits in plenty. It is easily destroyed by cooking, and so you have to take fresh fruits, and destroyed by cooking and canning and not by freezing. And it is very essential for the formation of the maintenance of collagen, and collagen is the intercellular material of the connective tissue, and also it is very important in wound repair and healing and mobilizes cholesterol in blood. Then the deficiency causes a disease called scurvy. You just see the diagram of a figure characterized by bleeding gums, loose teeth, swollen joints, skin eruptions, poor wound healing, etc. Now coming to the minerals. They are small molecules of diet requiring no digestion, and they cannot be synthesized by the cells, but they are essential to human body. They are taken either as salts in water or part of food, and since they need no digestion, they are absorbed directly from the gut. Some are called macro elements because they are needed in large quantity, and some others are called trace elements or micro elements since they are needed only in small quantity. Coming to macro elements, the first one is sodium. It is the main cation, that is the positively charged ion of the extracellular fluid. It forms a component of the bile salts, sodium glycocholate. Sodium is involved in osmotic balance, acid-base balance, absorption of glucose, and muscle and nerve impulse transmission. If there is a deficiency of sodium in the body, it produces muscle cramps. And of course, the chief source is our table salt. Now coming to the next one, chlorine, which is the major negatively charged ion of the extracellular fluid. Then major source is table salt. Then the major function is the formation of hydrochloric acid in the gut and keeping acid-base balance. Deficiency may cause omitting and a change in the plasma chloride ions, leading to a condition called hypochloremic alkalosis, that is hypo means low, a low chlorine content in the plasma. Then calcium, and we all know the importance of calcium because it is a major constituent of bones and teeth. Then it is essential for blood coagulation. When you study the chapter circulation, you will study the importance of calcium in blood coagulation, then neuromuscular function, cardiac function and functioning of many enzymes and hormones. And common sources are calcium, egg yolk, nuts, then carrot, then small fishes and green leafy vegetables. A large quantity of calcium present in green leafy vegetables, small fishes and milk. Then deficiency causes poor development of bones and teeth, stunted growth in children and osteoporosis, especially in women after menopause, then muscular spasm in adults. Then one important thing is vitamin D is essential for calcium absorption. So, hence the deficiency of vitamin D may also cause calcium deficiency. That is why doctors prescribe vitamin D along with calcium tablets. Then potassium, it is a cation present in, you remember potassium is a cation present in both intracellular and extracellular fluid, and it is also a component of the bile salt potassium taurocholate. It takes part in neuromuscular activities, fluid balancing and the synthesis of glycogen and protein. And potassium is present in fruits, grains, vegetables. Then phosphorus, it is a major element of bones and teeth. It is present as calcium phosphate. It is a component of nucleic acid, phospholipids and ATP. ATP, you know, adenosine triphosphate, and some coenzymes. It activates sugars and fatty acids by phosphorylation and helps to maintain the normal blood pH. Then the sources are milk, egg, meat and nuts. Now coming to magnesium. It is an enzyme activator and also a component of bones and teeth. It is required in muscle relaxation and for maintaining normal muscle and nerve function. And it is also helpful in keeping a healthy immune system, maintaining heart rhythm and maintaining strong bones. So, deficiency causes convulsions, cardiovascular diseases, anxiety disorders and osteoporosis. Present in spinach, nuts, seeds, grains, fish, curd, banana and dried fruits. Now coming to the micronutrients, then iron is the most important micronutrient and it is a constituent of the respiratory pigment hemoglobin, and it also occurs in other respiratory pigments like myoglobin, cytochrome and peroxidases. Deficiency in diet leads to a type of anemia called microcytic anemia, characterized by small RBC and hyperchromic RBC. Hyperchromic means you can see the hyperchromic RBC, hemoglobin less in quantity. Then what are the dietary sources? Brown grapes, dates, green leafy vegetables, liver, fish, wheat, etc. Then iodine, essential in the synthesis of thyroid hormone, and iodine is present in seafoods, onion and iodized salts, and you can see the diagram of goiter. And the deficiency reduces the secretion of thyroid hormone and causes simple goiter, that is enlargement of the thyroid gland. The next one micronutrient is cobalt. Of course, it is a component of vitamin B12 and causes pernicious anemia. Next one is sulfur. It is a component of many proteins, especially the amino acid methionine, and component of many enzymes, coenzymes and vitamins like biotin and thiamine. It is present in grapefruit and garlic. Grapefruit ennu parna aathachakka. Then coming to fluorine. Fluorine is essential to maintain the enamel of teeth and checks dental decay. See, you have seen in the advertisement of toothpaste, fluorine containing toothpaste, no? It is essential to maintain the enamel of teeth and checks dental decay. And drinking water is the natural source. And in areas where there is scarcity of fluorine, a small quantity of fluorine can be added to the water, and the process is called fluoridation. But excess quantity, it is harmful and it will cause corrosion to the bones and teeth. Then next we can deal with the malnutrition. What is malnutrition? Improper supply of food in excess or in deficient quantity to a person. If it is in excess quantity, it is called excess nutrition. If it is in deficient quantity, it is called undernutrition. Then, what is then a balanced diet? A diet which contains all the nutrients in optimum quantities and proportions, which is required to maintain the body in perfect health. That is called a balanced diet. So, any deviation from a balanced diet can cause a disease. Then coming to nutritional disorders. First, marasmus, and this is a figure showing a child having marasmus. This is a protein and calorie deficiency disorder, extremely weak and flabby body, thin limbs, prominent ribs, wrinkled skin, thin face and depressed eyes. The next one is Kwashiorkor. This is a protein deficiency disorder characterized by muscular wasting, retarded physical and mental growth, low immunity, bulged eyes, and enlarged liver and body, thin limbs and diarrhea. Then obesity, then that is the excessive accumulation of fat beneath the skin and around the internal organs, higher body weight. Then this can cause higher BP, increased risk of heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, etc. It may be due to overeating of energy rich compounds or malfunctioning of thyroid, pituitary or other sex glands or lack of exercise, etc. Then hypercholesterolemia, that is abnormally high levels of blood cholesterol, that is due to excessive intake of saturated fats like red meat, egg, butter, ghee, vegetable oils, etc. And excessive cholesterol may deposit in the inner walls of the blood vessels, leading to their stiffening, or the diameter of the internal cavity of the blood vessel may be reduced, and that can lead to increased blood pressure. And increased blood pressure can cause breakage of smaller blood vessels, especially to brain and heart, leading to cerebral hemorrhage, paralysis, and cardiovascular diseases, or even death. Now we can discuss some questions. Question number 1, arrange the following processes regarding holozoic nutrition in its correct order of events. See, the steps regarding holozoic nutrition are: food is first taken in, that is called ingestion, then it is digested, then digested food should be absorbed, and finally, the unabsorbed and undigested food is ingested out. So, the correct answer should be B, that is ingestion, digestion, absorption and ingestion. And all other choices are wrong, that is ingestion, digestion, absorption and ingestion are wrong. And choice C is also wrong, C choice D and E are wrong. So, the correct answer is ingestion, digestion, absorption and egestion. Then second question is, an organism which exhibits mixotrophic nutrition. The first choice is Mytilus viridis, and Mytilus viridis of course exhibits heterotrophic nutrition. So, the answer is wrong. Then Paramecium caudatum, it also shows heterotrophic nutrition. Then Trypanosoma gambiens, it is a parasitic protozoan. Choice D is also wrong. Then Ascaris lumbricoides, it is also a parasite. So, this choice is also wrong. Then coming to Euglena viridis, we have seen that Euglena viridis contains chloroplast and it is phototrophic in presence of sunlight, and in darkness it is saprophytic. So, mixotrophic nutrition is an animal which shows both types of, more than one type of nutrition. So, the answer is C, Euglena viridis. So, the third question is, the richest natural source of iodine are, the first is yeast, liver, egg and pulses, that is protein containing food. The second one is all fruits, that is vitamin C containing food. Third one is also vitamin C containing food. Then the last one is green leafy vegetables containing iron. So, the answer should be seafoods and iodine, seafoods and onion. Seafoods and iodine, onion are the natural richest source of iodine. Then question number 4, examination of the blood of a person suspected of having anemia shows large immature nucleated RBC, that is macrocytic anemia. Supplement his diet with which of the following is likely to alleviate the symptoms. So, we have seen that macrocytic anemia is caused due to the deficiency of folic acid. Deficiency of iron causes microcytic anemia. Deficiency of riboflavin causes chylosis and glossitis. Then deficiency of cyanocobalamin causes pernicious anemia, and deficiency of folic acid causes macrocytic anemia. So, the person should say take folic acid. Then question number 5, consider the following statements with regard to nutrition, and of the above statements which is true. The first statement, all vertebrates and most invertebrates have holozoic nutrition. The statement is right. Some bacteria, fungi and few protozoans have saprozoic nutrition, and this statement is also true. Then pathogenic bacteria, viruses and trypanosoma have parasitic nutrition, and this statement is also right, because pathogenic bacteria are parasitic, viruses are parasitic, trypanosoma is also parasitic. Trichonympha have symbiotic nutrition, that we have seen. So, A, B, C and D are true. So, E is the correct answer. The question number 6, out of the following, which pair is not correctly matched? Vitamin K, prolonged use of antibiotics may result in the deficiency of this vitamin. It is correct. Then vitamin E is needed for cellular metabolism and cellular differentiation. Correct. Then vitamin D deficiency leads to loss of calcium and phosphorus from bones. Correct. And vitamin A is needed for correct formation of epithelial tissue. So, it is known as anti-infection vitamin, that is also correct pair. But vitamin B2 is not an anti-pellagra vitamin. Vitamin B2 is riboflavin and its deficiency causes chylosis. and pellagra is caused due to the deficiency of vitamin B5. So, this is not correctly matched. Then question number 7, find the wrongly matched pair. Phosphorus is a component of ATP and coenzymes. Iron is a respiratory pigment. Deficiency of iodine causes deficiency of secretion of thyroid hormone. Sodium is a component of bile salt. And here cobalt is not a component of bones and teeth. So, it is the wrongly matched pair. So, D is the correct answer. And question number 8, here certain definitions are given and which pair is not correctly matched. First one, conversion of excess glucose in the blood to glycogen and stored in the liver, and this process is called glycogenesis. It is correctly matched. Stored glycogen in the liver is broken down to glucose, that is called glycogenolysis, we have seen. Under acute starvation, the liver cells convert non-carbohydrate materials to glucose, that is called gluconeogenesis, that is also correct. The process by which products of digestion are incorporated into the body tissue, that is called assimilation, that is also correct. And energy expended by an organism during moderate exercise, that is not called basal metabolic rate. We have seen energy expended by an organism during rest is called basal metabolic rate. So, this is not correctly matched. So, E is the correct answer. So, question number 9, following are the symptoms of a vitamin deficiency disease. A child is suffering from painful joints, defective teeth, bowing of legs and beaded ribs. Out of the following food combination, which one do you select to treat the child? We know that these are the symptoms of a vitamin D deficiency disease in children, that is rickets. And shark liver oil, milk, egg and milk products of rich in vitamin D. And orange, lemon and pineapple, they are fruits, they are rich in vitamin C. Then yeast, bedam and nuts, and that is not the answer. Green leafy vegetable and fruits, again this is not the answer. And meat, cereals and pulses, and also that is not the answer. So, the child has to be treated with vitamin, the choice given in the A, that is shark liver oil, milk, egg and milk products. Then the last question, question number 10, read the statements regarding minerals and choose the right option. Minerals are small molecules of diet requiring no digestion. So, that is correct because they are absorbed directly from the gut. They cannot be synthesized by the cells. That is also correct. C, for the construction of tissues, some minerals such as potassium, calcium, magnesium, chlorine and phosphorus are required in larger amounts and are called macro elements. That is also correct. We have seen these are all macro elements. And the last one, sodium is the main anion of the extracellular fluid. It is wrong. Sodium is the main cation of the extracellular fluid. So, A, B and C are correct. So, the choice B is the correct answer. With this, the class is over. Thank you.